to you by Penguin.
The Blazing World and Other Writings by Margaret Cavendish, read by Abigail Thaw. Introduction by the editor, Kate Lilley.
Both for ease of listening and because it contains details of the plot, we've placed the introduction to this Penguin classic at the end of the audiobook.
The Contract. A noble gentleman that had been married many years, but his wife being barren, did bear him no children. At last she died, and his friends did advise him to marry again, because his brother's children were dead, and his wife was likely to have no more. So he took to wife a virtuous young lady, and after 1 year she conceived with child, and great joy there was of all sides. But in her childbed she died, leaving only one daughter to her sorrowful husband, who in a short time, oppressed with melancholy, died and left his young daughter, who was not a year old, to the care and breeding of his brother, and withal left her a great estate, for he was very rich. After the ceremonies of the funeral, his brother carried the child home, which was nursed up very carefully by his wife, and being all that was likely to succeed in their family, the uncle grew extreme fond and tender of his niece, insomuch that she grew all the comfort and delight of his life. A great duke, which commanded that province, would often come and eat breakfast with this gentleman as he rid a hunting, and so often they met after this manner that there grew a great friendship, for this gentleman was well-bred, knowing the world by his travels in his younger days, and though he had served in the wars and had fought in many battles, yet was not ignorant of courtly entertainment. Besides, he was very conversable, for he had a voluble tongue and a ready understanding, and in his retired life was a great student, whereby he became an excellent scholar, so that the Duke took great delight in his company. Besides, the Duke had a desire to match the niece of this gentleman, his friend, to his younger son, having only two sons, and knowing this child had a great estate left by her father, and was likely to have her uncle's estate joined thereto, was earnest upon it. But her uncle was unwilling to marry her to a younger brother, although he was of a great family. But with much persuasion, he agreed, and gave his consent, when she was old enough to marry, for she was then not 7 years old. But the Duke fell very sick, and when the physicians told him he could not live, he sent for the gentleman and his niece to take his last farewell. And when they came, the Duke desired his friend that he would agree to join his niece and his son in marriage. He answered that he was very willing, if she were of years to consent. Said the Duke, "I desire we may do our parts, which is to join them as fast as we can, for youth is wild, various, and inconstant. And when I am dead, I know not how my son may dispose of himself when he is left to his own choice." For he privately found his son very unwilling thereto, he being a man grown, and she a child. The gentleman, seeing him so desirous, agreed thereto. Then the Duke called his son privately to him, and told him his intentions were to see him bestowed in marriage before he died. His son desired him not to marry him against his affections in marrying him to a child. His father told him she had a great estate, and it was like to be greater by reason all the revenue was laid up to increase it. And besides, she was likely to be heir to her uncle, who loved her as his own child. "And her riches may draw so many suitors when she is a woman," said he, "that you may be refused." He told his father her riches could not make him happy if he could not affect her. Whereupon the Duke grew so angry that he said that his disobedience would disturb his death, leaving the world with an unsatisfied mind. Whereupon he seemed to consent, to please his father. Then were they as firmly contracted as the priest could make them, and two or three witnesses to avow it. But after his father was dead, he, being discontented, went to the wars. But in short time he was called from thence, by reason his elder brother died, and so the dukedom and all the estate came to him, being then the only heir. but he never came near the young lady, nor so much as sent to her, for he was at that time extremely in love with a great lady who was young and handsome, being wife to a grandee who was very rich, but was very old, whose age made her more facile to young lovers, especially to this young duke, who returned him equal affections. He being a man that was favoured by nature, fortune, and breeding, for he was very handsome, and of a ready wit, active, valiant, full of generosity, affable, well-fashioned, and had he not been sullied with some debaucheries, he had been the completest man in that age. But the old gentleman, perceiving his neglect towards his niece, and hearing of his affections to that lady, strove by all the care and industry he could to give her such breeding as might win his love. Not that he was negligent before she was contracted to him, for from the time of 4 years old she was taught all that her age was capable of, as to sing and to dance, for he would have this artificial motion become as natural and to grow in perfection as she grew in years. When she was 7 years of age, he chose her such books to read in as might make her wise, not amorous, for he never suffered her to read in romances, nor such light books, but moral philosophy was the first of her studies, to lay a ground and foundation of virtue, and to teach her to moderate her passions and to rule her affections. The next, her study was in history, to learn her experience by the second hand, reading the good fortunes and misfortunes of former times, the errors that were committed, the advantages that were lost, the humour and dispositions of men, the laws and customs of nations, their rise and their fallings, of their wars and agreements and the like. The next study was in the best of poets, to delight in their fancies and to recreate in their wit, and this she did not only read, but repeat what she had read every evening before she went to bed. Besides, he taught her to understand what she read by explaining that which was hard and obscure. Thus she was always busily employed, for she had little time allowed her for childish recreations. Thus did he make her breeding his only business and employment, for he lived obscurely and privately, keeping but a little family, and having little or no acquaintance, but lived a kind of a monastical life. But when the niece was about 13 years of age, he heard the Duke was married to the lady with whom he was enamoured, for her husband dying, leaving her a widow and rich, she claimed a promise from him that he made her whilst her husband was living, that when he died, being an old man and not likely to live long, to marry her, although he was loath. For men that love the pleasures of the world care not to be encumbered and obstructed with a wife. But he did not at all reflect upon his contract, for after his father died, he resolved not to take her to wife, for she being so young, he thought the contract of no validity. But the lady, seeming more coy when she was a widow than in her husband's time, seeking thereby to draw him to marry her, and being overcome by several ways of subtlety, he married her. Whereupon the uncle was mightily troubled, and was very melancholy, which his niece perceived, and desired of him to know the cause. Whereupon he told her, "Is this the only reason?" said she. "Yes," said he. "And doth it not trouble you?" said he. "No," said she, "unless I had been forsaken for some sinful crime I had committed against heaven, or had infringed the laws of honour, or had broken the rules of modesty, or some misdemeanour against him, or some defect in nature, then I should have lamented, but not for the loss of the man, but for the cause of the loss. For then all the world might have justly defamed me with a dishonourable reproach. But now I can look the world in the face with a confident brow as innocence can arm it. Besides, it was likely I might have been unhappy in a man that could not affect me. Wherefore, good uncle, be not melancholy, but think that fortune hath befriended me, or that destiny had decreed it so to be. If so, we are to thank the one, and it was impossible to avoid the other. And if the fates spin a long thread of your life, I shall never murmur for that loss, but give thanks to the gods for that blessing." "Oh, but child," said he, the Duke was the greatest and richest match since his brother died in the kingdom, and I would not have thy virtue, beauty, youth, wealth, and breeding stoop to a low fortune when thou mayest be a match fit for the emperor of the whole world in a few years if you grow up and go on as you have begun." "Oh, uncle," said she, "let not your natural affection make you an impartial judge to give the sentence of more desert than I can own. If I have..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.